made the money, and so we could actually finish the restaurant. And I tell everybody that, you know, Pram is really the father and owner of our restaurant. And when I talked a few times, even in the old times, he had lunch with Marvin Davis very often. And I introduced Marvin, said, "You know who Pram is?" I said, "Yes, Marvin, he owns the restaurant." And Marvin just looked at me and said, "What are you talking about?" And Pram said, "Yeah, I gave him a little money. What's wrong with that?" And Marvin said, "I should have done the same thing. Why you didn't put me in the deal?" And many times when I tell people the story, I see how proud Pram was when I told the story that he, because of him, we have the restaurant here. He had a little smile and a twinkle in his eyes and just looked at me and he said, "You know what, I'm very proud. I was very excited and very happy that you actually paid me back and that the restaurant is still successful." So for me and so many other small businesses out there who Pram helped because he believed in the community, he believed in people. And I think we see that very seldom today where people tell you stories, but they don't walk the walk. And Pram was always a man who walked the walk. So for me, I admire him, Elaine, his whole family. You're really special to Galila, to us. Many of our people who work at Spago, when I told them that Pram won't come for lunch anymore, they said, "What?" And I said, "Yeah, it's the end." But he lived an amazing life. And I really believe we all should look up to him and say, he is our idol. I know he's my idol because he was one of the people who dreamed the dream and really lived the dream. So Pram, I have a drink on you later. And to the family, my condolences. I will miss him forever. Thank you.
Bram Goldsmith embraced life. A man devoted to his family, a man of enormous business and civic consequence, a man who was a member of what has been called the greatest generation. Soldiers who returned from war determined to forge a successful, a vibrant, a reimagined nation. It's fair to say, both metaphorically and in real time, Bram sure made an impression. And let's admit it, he did not suffer fools gladly. But what you might not know about Bram is how very much he loved music. You could always find Elaine and Bram on Thursday nights in row A of Walt Disney Concert Hall, and Tuesday nights in his box at the Hollywood Bowl, which was happily just in front of mine. So there were so many magical evenings we all shared together. He was such an enthusiast, and he generally loved everything that he heard. But when he didn't, I received a full report. Bram was a life director of the Los Angeles Philharmonic, having served on our board since 1977. We were so fortunate to have him. Back in 2000, something you might not know, he literally helped to save the Philharmonic from what was then a profound crisis. Yes, one of those crises where we can't make payroll type of crisis. My job as the new CEO was to convince him that there was a viable business and artistic plan for the future and towards the future. Winning his confidence and the privilege of his counsel was a formative experience for me. Our executive committee meetings took place at the enormous round table in the City National Boardroom. It sort of felt like the Star Chamber. But once sold, Bram was a vocal advocate for the film. He was a leading investor in our future and endowed the Bram and Elaine Goldsmith Principal Cello Chair. And without a major loan from City National Bank, I have to tell you the truth, today I might well be managing the Fresno Philharmonic. I'm not. It's a rare person that combines this kind of vision and pragmatism, but Bram was that rare person. He believed deeply that a community needs the arts to uplift and inspire us and to connect us all. His willingness to share, his generosity, and his expertise in service of our community is the reason the LA Phil and, of course, the Wallis Annenberg Center thrive today. As Bram's bet on the LA Phil paid off, our friendship developed. Over lunches at Hillcrest, we discussed everything from what Itzhak Perlman is really like, no golf jokes for me, his experiences in Burma, politics. You know, we always really laughed a lot. And Elaine would be over at another table with her girlfriends, and we would wave, and it just felt like family. So today we remember Bram in this beautiful hall, which carries his name. We celebrate an extraordinary man and an extraordinary life while paying respects to the entire Goldsmith family, to Elaine, Bruce, Russell, and to your families. We send you our love, our support in this difficult time. You know, sometimes I think, why on these occasions of remembrance and farewell do we choose mournful music? Instead, why not send our loved ones off in a joyous, joyous celebration of the life, of the vibrant life they lived? Today, there is a special Bram meaning to the piece you will hear, the Prelude in E Major from Bach's Solo Violin Partita. These were the very first notes of music that Bram and Elaine and the audience heard on that legendary night when we opened Walt Disney Concert Hall. Some of you might remember that our concertmaster, Martin Chalifour, hiked all the way up to the heavens of the hall and precariously perched high in the organ loft. He played this glorious presto. That was a night that would not have happened without Bram. So this afternoon, Martin Chalifour is here to represent the orchestra and to play this very piece for you, but most especially for Bram. Thank you, my dear friend, for a life well lived. You will be missed. You made a difference. Journey well. Journey joyously. Thank you. Thank you.
On behalf of my family, thank you so much for being here today. We really appreciate it. I want to thank in particular Rabbi Leder and Cantor Gurney for doing such a wonderful job leading this service. I think Deborah and I had a similar idea. That is, about 15 years ago, Tom Brokaw wrote a book called The Greatest Generation, which I'm sure many of you saw and read. It was the story of ordinary men and women born in the decade after World War I, who overcame a Great Depression, saved the world from Hitler, and then came home, put their medals in drawers, and built modern America. I gave Grandpa the book, and I inscribed it to the greatest man I know. He was moved, but also a little embarrassed. He thanked me and said something like, "I've been very fortunate," which was about as arrogant as he got. And then he turned Jeopardy back on. My grandfather led a big and heroic life. He was the son of poor immigrants who ascended to heights his parents could not have imagined. He spent 2 years in the jungles of Burma fighting for this country. He took risks, led businesses, endured setbacks, recovered, and always managed to get the impossible boulder up the hill. He built not one, but two extraordinary companies in real estate with Lynn's dad and in banking, and that is what made him a success. But it is not what made him a great man. His character made him great. He was a tough kid who stood up to bullies rather than becoming one. He was a romantic who fell in love with my grandmother at first sight, told her he would marry her on their second date. She thought he was nuts, and then worshiped her for the rest of his life. He was a leader who could do the hard thing, push you to be better, and inspire not just respect, but lasting loyalty and affection. He was a man to whom practically nothing had been given, but still believed that much was expected. So he threw himself into Tikkun Olam, making the world a better place. And from the Federation to the hospital to the symphony to Otis to this building to the countless individuals he helped in their hour of need and never talked about, we are all surrounded by examples of his generosity and care. And today, I am filled with happy memories. He was a deeply devoted grandfather. When I wasn't in town, we spoke on the phone at least once a week. And these calls were such a pleasure. Sometimes we'd talk about work. More often, we spoke about our mutual passion for politics and movies and good food. I love visiting him at the bank. I used to call the office his habitat. He seemed so comfortable there. It was where he could ask me subtle and probing questions like, when the hell are you and Claire gonna have a baby? His follow-up was, she's a beautiful girl, do I have to explain to you how this works? I cut him off there. We took amazing trips together. We were so lucky. We went to Europe, to Alaska, and Hawaii. But for whatever reason, what sticks in my mind are the quieter moments. Barbecue in the backyard, boat rides in Newport Beach, gin rummy, tennis games. Neither of us was especially good at tennis. It became kind of a running joke that whenever the two of us played, we both lost. And my sister Katie actually reminded me, I hadn't remembered this. There were so many occasions in which my grandmother and grandfather would come home from playing tennis together, which they did all the time, and my grandfather was just soaking wet. I mean, just, he was done. And my grandmother had just the faintest perception of a glow. And I would ask her who won, and she said, well, I always win. And he would kind of hoof it up the stairs, and you know, she would sort of sit down and nibble on a tangerine, kind of half smile, barely visible on her face. It was in those quiet moments that I could just hang out with him, listen to him, laugh with him, hope that a tiny bit of his magic would rub off. I learned so much from my grandfather, but I think three things mattered most to him. Doing your best, doing it with integrity, and giving back to the community. He lived those values more than anyone I've ever met. He would have been embarrassed to be called the greatest anything, but for those of us who knew him, he was really the greatest everything.
In my earliest memories of my grandfather, he's always presiding over something. Whether he was handing out Haggadah assignments from the head of the dinner table, or striding through a group of toddlers perfectly pressed at a birthday party, he was so clearly and forcefully in charge. Even to my young eyes, it was clear that the rest of us followed in his wake. As Bram's grandchild, I had a unique, one of five unique, relationship with him. I think he loved us in a gentler and more immediate way than he did most people. Yes, he wanted us to succeed the way he had, and he had expectations for us as he did for his own children, but with us, he started out already on our team. Because of that, we saw a side of him that it took most people much longer to gain access to. With us, he was caring, funny, and sly. Every year, my family spends the 4th of July weekend with my grandparents in Newport Beach. One night about 3 years ago, my brother and I asked my grandfather to teach us how to play poker. Bram sat us down at the breakfast table and explained how to play, talked us through a practice round, and then beat us mercilessly. Of course, he was the expert and we were just beginners, but something about the speed and the ease with which he trounced us seemed a little too convenient. It was only later that I realized he'd sat us with our backs to a mirrored wall so he could see all our cards. I told him this, and he laughed. I'd caught him, but he wanted us to notice. The game was more than just a testament to his long-developed skill. My grandfather's acute social intelligence and negotiating awareness, his understanding of how to use every given situation in his favor, gave rise to an aphorism I think about often: never play cards with your back to a mirror. In a larger sense, you should know more than just your own plans or the facts as you see them. Be aware of your surroundings and your opponent, and if possible, your opponent's cards. Especially in the last few years, my grandfather tried to teach us the lessons he had learned throughout his life. He reinforced the importance of working for your successes. Bram never played easy to let us win a game. You had to earn it, even as his grandchildren. About 2 months ago, I was home from college on winter break and sitting in my grandparents' den, talking to him about the summer job applications I'd filled out that day, what classes I wanted to take. He heard that a few of the jobs were related to finance, and he decided that I would go interview at the bank to see if they had a summer position. I tried to express my reservations that it wasn't what I wanted to do, that I was looking for jobs on the East Coast, that I wanted to strike out and try something myself. But my grandfather, as you might expect, stood firm. Despite my resistance, he insisted that I bring my resume to his house in the morning so he could take it to HR the following day. I went back to his house the next day, knowing that I had to tell him no and dreading it. Bram was a hard man to say no to. Once he decided he wanted something, he was unstoppable. That's so often the reason why he achieved so much, but was also the reason why my hand shook as I delivered my argument. I thanked him profusely for his offer of help, but reiterated that, although I was hugely flattered by his proposal, I wanted to pursue other possibilities first and didn't want him to initiate any process at the bank. When I finished, astonished that I was still standing, he told me that he respected me for being honest with him. He said that, as my grandfather, his role was to support me in the things that I wanted and to help when he could, but not to make me follow a path that he outlined. As I was about to leave the house, he called me back to his wheelchair to tell me that he loved me. It was the moment that made me feel like he respected my character and me as a person, not just as his grandchild. In considering my future, I can only hope to find a job I love as much as my grandfather loved his, to be as driven and unstoppable as he was, and, once he decided that someone passed his tests, to be as generous and caring as he could be at his very best. I loved him because he was my grandfather, but I also loved him because he was one of the most incredible, upstanding, dedicated, and genuine people I have ever met. In the past few days, our family has heard from so many people who saw Bram as a mentor, a father figure, and a role model. He touched so many lives directly, and he walked through so many more as he led by example. I feel so lucky to have been one of those people, to have known him and had him as a role model, but even more so to have had him be that person as my grandfather. I will always prize my time and relationship with him and will strive to be the kind of person he would respect. Thank you.
It is truly a pleasure to look out and see so many faces here to celebrate my grandfather. It seems odd to say he would have loved this, but he would have. My grandpa Bram was a leader, a visionary, and a builder. As we heard Wallace Annenberg say, he envisioned, fought for, and created the building we're in now, along with many others. All across the city, he's left his mark. With Buckeye emblems down Wilshire, his name on the Jewish Federation's high rise, a chair at the Philharmonic, a new campus for Otis, and the always popular Bram Award at City National, just to name a few. But for anyone who knew him, these are not the things that first come to mind. Instead, it's his integrity, his kindness, his elegance, his generosity, his optimism, his smile. Few people told a better joke than my grandpa, and it didn't matter if it was the first time or the fifth, you'd better believe it was funny. He took immense joy in making others happy, and that he certainly did. A former teller at CNB said, "He always treated me like I was a CEO." He understood how to connect with people, regardless if that person was a senator, a member of the Jackson Five, or a busboy. People mattered to him, and he, in turn, truly mattered to them. Just going out to dinner with him would inevitably mean running into people he knew and hearing their stories of how he'd helped them start a business, launch a career, or did them a favor without any expectation of anything in return. He saw the potential in people and always did whatever he could to help them achieve it. He truly touched lives in meaningful, memorable, and really selfless ways. But of everything he built, his family was most important to him, and I am forever grateful to be a part of that. He taught me that family means unconditional love. It means you're always there for each other, no matter the circumstance. It means telling the truth, even if it's not easy to hear. In fact, especially when it's not easy to hear. It means being proud of where you came from, and like him, having the strength to build your own future. The grandpa I will always remember is the one who took me for boat rides in Newport, played doubles with me, Brian, and Grandma, but Grandma always won, spent a month in Tuscany with me, schlepping up windy staircases to the tops of churches because I wanted to see the view, and looked out the window every morning across the rolling Italian hills and said, "If you've got to suffer." For someone who accomplished so much, whose mind was always going a mile a minute, he also managed to appreciate every moment, both the big, glitzy, celebratory ones, and there were many, and the smaller, quieter ones that so often go unnoticed. He saw the extraordinary in the ordinary and found equal joy in extravagance and in the everyday. Just last week, I visited him at Cedars, armed with a portable Bose speaker and an iPod full of all the music he loved listening to at the Hollywood Bowl, at Disney Hall, and in this very room. I figured 9 hours worth of Itzhak Perlman was at least enough to last him until the next day. And as we sat there listening, he asked me how I was doing, what I was working on, And of course, how was my love life? He wasn't much for beating around the bush. He told me that finding the right person is all that matters. And as I held his hand, listening to Sinatra, he talked about my grandmother. How, when they first met, he didn't think he had much going for him, but she thought he was a star. And if she thought so, then he had to make it true. In his eyes, she was always right, even if that meant no desserts for all of January. They had the kind of marriage people dream of, and they set the example of the life I hope to lead. I truly can't imagine a world without my grandfather in it, but I see pieces of him in my father, in my brother, and maybe, if I'm lucky, in me too. Sinatra may have coined the phrase, but Bram Goldsmith truly lived the good life.
First of all, I'd like to thank all of you for being here today at the Bram Goldsmith Theater. I also want to thank the people who we couldn't fit in to this theater and are elsewhere listening to the live feed. My family and I look forward to seeing all of you at the reception afterwards. I know also a lot of our colleagues at City National are watching this on our live webcast, and I welcome you to this ceremony. In addition, on behalf of my family, I also want to thank all the fabulous participants in today's ceremony, Rabbi Leder, Cantor Gurney, Deborah Borda, Wolfgang Puck, Wallace, of course, Wallace Annenberg, and that marvelous concertmaster, Martin Chalifour. My kids are right. It would mean so much to my father that you are all here today. So on behalf of my mother and our entire family, I just want to thank you very much for your support, friendship, and love for my father and for our family. Some of you know I give a fair number of speeches, but this is truly the one speech I never wanted to give, because I never wanted this day to come. And on some level, I could not really believe it would, and still can't. My father was always there for me. And for the last 20 plus years, that was literally true virtually every day. As my daughter said, my dad often said he was very fortunate. Well, I was very fortunate. He was my father. And I believe all of us in this community were very fortunate. He was here for 93 years. He made every one of those years count. He made a very positive difference in so many ways that we've heard some of today, but he did that with so many people, companies, and causes. Today, you've heard some aspects of his life and his character, but we really don't have enough time for all his good works and all the great stories about a life so well lived, a man so well respected and loved. I was particularly privileged, as many of you know, to have a very special vantage point and relationship with my father, and so I thought I should share some of what I know about him with you today. I saw him up close for 20 years, and the man you think you know is the man that was there in private as well as in public. As you know, as you've heard, my father was a truly great entrepreneur, builder, and visionary, a dynamic and charismatic leader all his life, and an amazing and devoted husband, father, grandfather, and friend. But he worked hard. He worked hard for his entire life, starting as a teenage soda jerk like out of It's a Wonderful Life, deep in the Depression, the loving son of Jewish immigrants with very little money. And he truly never stopped working and helping his family and giving back to his community and country, from his service in World War II to the turnaround of a lousy business he bought in Chicago, to moving to California and building Buckeye into what he always said was the largest private real estate development firm in LA in the 60s and 70s, and then building City National for the next 40 years. And through it all, generously supporting his family and his extended family and innumerable charities. What he built, I think that word is important, what he built was important to him his whole life, whether it was his incredible marriage to my mother, and I guess the cat is out of the bag that she's 39 and yet married for 73 years. He was proud of that and proud of our family of four and then six and then his beloved five grandchildren, as well as his two sisters and so many nieces and nephews and cousins and people in need, or whether it was the buildings Buckeye built or the Goldsmith Center for the Jewish Federation or, as we know, this theater we're in today. My dad liked stories, told stories, so let me tell you a quick, probably almost a last story about my dad. Last Friday, I was with him in his room at Cedars, and we were getting him packed up to finally bring him home. And I looked out the window of his room at Cedars, and the angle was such that I saw an office building that he and George Conheim had built at Wilshire and Doheny. And I happened to know that's my dad's favorite building that they built. And so I pointed it out to him, that, Dad, there's your beautiful building. And one of the ambulance guys who we'd been talking to said, oh, what did your dad do? And I said, well, he was at one time a developer and he built some office buildings. And amidst all the hubbub to get him packed up, his voice rang out, 32 buildings in Beverly Hills. He didn't miss a beat. And that, honestly, was just part of what they built. And that was before he ever became a banker. Clearly, he took great pride in what he built, rightfully so. For someone who built so much and was so successful after starting out with virtually nothing, except I would point out some amazing values from his parents, it occurred to me as I thought about this, my father never really cared about material things. He was focused on doing things. For all his success, it was about being able to do more for others, helping his family and the many causes in the community that he believed in, that you've heard about, that so many of you are involved in, like Cedars and the Federation and the Philharmonic, and so many others here in Beverly Hills, in LA, in the US, and in Israel. For him, it was also about helping so many relatives and other people he knew to go to college, to get a second chance, to start a business, or just live out their lives with enough money to have some dignity and be okay. My father was obviously immensely proud and pleased by what was accomplished at City National, not just by him, but he would be the first to say, by so many colleagues, for so many clients, communities, and shareholders. But trust me, he was the one most responsible for the success and reputation, the values and value proposition of City National Bank. One of the many, many things he loved about banking was the ability it gave him to help so many other people, like Wolf's beautiful remarks, or Deborah's. Whether it was colleagues building a career, or a family or an entrepreneur who needed help on the way up. You would be amazed how many successful entrepreneurs in this town have come up to me over the last 20 years to tell me how my father took a chance on them and loaned them the money they needed to kickstart their success. As most of you already knew before you walked in, my father was incredibly generous. He shared and gave, but not just with money, but of himself, of his energy and his time and wisdom, certainly to me and our family and extended family, but also to his friends, to his colleagues in business and banking, to his clients at the bank, to the countless charitable organizations he led, to the club he loved, and to strangers he met. As you've heard, he believed in and lived a life of giving back, of making a difference, of responding to needs and opportunities. He said emphatically that a life that wasn't productive really was a life not worth living, and he lived that belief his whole life. Let me give you just two examples. In his late 70s and through his 80s, he took on the daunting challenge, as was mentioned by Wallis, of turning that old post office into this magnificent state-of-the-art performing arts center. It was his way of giving back to Beverly Hills, where he had lived and worked for 60 years. And at the same time, he never stopped working and leading and inspiring at City National, serving on its board for 50 years, as its chairman for nearly 40 years, and as its CEO for 20 years. In fact, about a year ago, somebody at Hillcrest asked my dad if he still was going into the office every day, and characteristically he shot back, "No, not on Saturdays or Sundays." In fact, just literally 3 weeks ago, on February 16th, he was at our senior management committee until 5:30, when he said to me quietly, "I think I'm going to go home now." The next morning, unexpectedly, he went back to Cedars. Through his whole life, my father treated everyone with the same level of respect and kindness, of friendly good humor and easy communication. It reminds me of a few lines from a famous Rudyard Kipling poem that I think fits my father very well. "If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it." No matter who they were or what the situation, as Steve Leader noted, my father always seemed to have the right thing to say to connect with people, in part because he genuinely liked and enjoyed just about everyone he knew or met, even if it was just for a moment. He especially loved working with and talking with our clients and colleagues at the bank. I'll give you one example that every colleague at City National knows. There was nothing my father liked more than gathering once a month in the bank's Bram Goldsmith boardroom with all of those colleagues who were celebrating that month their 5-year, 10-year, 20-year, even 40-year anniversary with the bank. He did this every month. He would thank our colleagues, talk with them, listen to them, and then they would each get a personal picture taken with my dad. And if you go around City National to the desks of thousands of colleagues, you will see they proudly display their picture with Bram, now more precious than ever. Many of you know that over the last 10 years, my father fought courageously and quietly the debilitating and ultimately deadly effects of neuropathy. For a man of such dignity and elegance, strength and independence, it had to be very hard to suffer the indignities and difficulties of this incurable condition. But he never complained or let it show. He never gave up and never gave in. For my mother, who my father fell in love with at first sight, and for me and Karen and our children, Brian, Claire, Katie, and Annie, losing my dad is incredibly sad and painful, even if he was 93. But it is his example that will inspire us to move ahead, and the support of everyone here is helping us today. This is supposed to be both a memorial and a celebration, so I want to close my remarks by sharing with you just how great the last 4 months of my dad's life were, in spite of his failing health, and how much joy he really had. On November 2nd, He was thrilled that City National merged with the Royal Bank of Canada, and that he got to celebrate with our colleagues at the bank and with Dave Mackay and the management and board of RBC. At the closing dinner, of course, at Spago, Dave and I gave speeches, but it was my father who had the best line. He asked for the mic sitting at his table, and with incredible enthusiasm, he said, "This is the greatest night of my life." I'm not sure it was true. But the important thing is he felt that way, and he got to see that happen, and I know how much that meant to him. Then just a week later, here at the Annenberg Center, there was a spectacular gala many of you were at, saluting his critical leadership in getting this built as its founding chairman. Early in January, he loved coming over to our house. We had an event for Hillary Clinton, who he got to talk to and get a picture with, and spent an hour with Warren Buffett and some of her supporters. He was thrilled about being in that night. Then just about a month ago, we did something we do every year at City National. We had our, what was then the 39th annual leadership meeting, an event he started 39 years earlier. And as always, he received a spontaneous standing ovation from the top 500 leaders at the bank. Just a little over 2 weeks ago, my mother and I, along with Karen and my mother-in-law, celebrated my birthday and Valentine's Day with my dad, a gift that we'll always remember. And then 8 days later, it was his 93rd birthday. That's an amazing 4 months for a man who turned 93, I think, and a fitting conclusion. So right up to the very end, my father truly enjoyed his life, his family and friends and work. He remained totally sharp mentally, but finally he was at home, surrounded by his family, listening to Katie's classical music until he went peacefully to sleep. So while today is very sad for our family, there is so much to celebrate about my dad and to be forever grateful that we were so fortunate, so very blessed to have known him, to have had him, and in my case, to be his son and even his partner. Thank you all very much for being with us here today to honor and celebrate something quite rare, in my view, a truly great man and a life well lived. Thank you.
Please rise for the memorial prayer.
El malerachamim shochein bamromim hametzeh minuchanechona Tachat kanfei ha-shchina B'mahalot kedoshim u'tohorim Kezohar ha-rakia Kezohar ha-rakia Shmat Avram ben Moshe shehalach liyalamo Yastirechu say terken afav liolamim v'yisror pitzror achayim et nishmato Adonai unacharato v'yonuach b'shalom al mishkavo v'nomar
O God, full of compassion, eternal spirit of the universe, grant perfect rest under the wings of your presence to Bram, who has entered eternity. Master of mercy, let him find refuge forever in the shadow of your wings, and let his soul be bound up in the bond of eternal life. The eternal God is his inheritance. May he rest in peace. And let us say, Amen. Please be seated.
High school, and which of course this was during the Depression, I started to work when I was 14, and I was working in a drugstore full time from 4 to 12 every day, and that's the money I had to spend and to do things with. In that experience, a close friend of mine who I went to school with, he went on a date one night with Elaine. And I went on a date with another girl, and I decided that his date was much better than mine, and she was too good for him. So anyway, I invited her out, and we went out, and we started dating. In fact, I said to your mother, you know, I'm gonna marry you someday. And she said, you're nuts. I think I was 17 or 18, and she was a little bit younger. And
at least 5 years.
Yeah, as your girlfriend would say. And nevertheless, I prevailed, and thank God for that, and you should be happy too. So Elaine and I decided to get married because I was going to be in Chicago for another 2 years. Your mother and I went on a honeymoon. Second day we were there, I got a telegram. Program canceled. Report immediately for active duty. So I get obviously reported for active duty.
I was in Florida after I went through basic training. And Elaine was with me for part of the time. In fact, my dad came out right before I went overseas to spend a few days with me.
I was in a commando unit, which was, until I was in the unit, was restricted to officers, single men, and volunteers. They ran out of all three categories, and I was one of the first married men that was luckily selected to be one of the commandos, and we were relieving troops in China and troops in Burma. It was lousy weather, but nobody got killed. I got discharged in San Francisco in the latter part of 45 when the war was over. And I went to work for Elaine's dad because I had nothing.
Inviting beaches, paradise for sportsmen, rendezvous for romance under sunny skies. This is the lure of the West. Along the golden shores of California.
We left Chicago New Year's Day, 1952. And it was amazing because the next day we arrived in California and the sun was out and we couldn't believe the difference. And arrived in Beverly Hills and moved into a house that my parents had rented for us.
My whole childhood growing up, my father was in the real estate business. And I remember one day he got my mother, my brother and I to sit down in our old house and say to us, look, I'm thinking of making a major change. He had the opportunity to shift from being an outside director to becoming CEO of City National Bank. And it was a big risk at the time. The bank was under pressure, but he made it work. We knew he would. Easier for us to say it than for him to do it. And it obviously turned out to be great for him, for our family, and about 20 years later, it was great for me as well.
What banking has represented to me is an opportunity to help people and help others in many ways.
From the beginning, this bank was always dedicated to the responsibility that we had to a community and how we develop people and how we give them opportunities.
What you get from your parents, if you're lucky as I've been, is values.
Bram sets the overall tenor of the bank, which is that element of the customer service. You know, we're a fairly major sized bank, but a lot of our customers have met with Bram.
Clients call up and they want this and this and this, and their officer is saying, no, you can't have this and this. I want to talk to Bram. And the client would walk out of his office thanking Bram, but he still said no.
I've learned from Bram, you can be successful in this business doing the right thing. And that's something that we think about every day, every minute of every day, is do the right thing. That may not be the best thing for the short-term answer to a solution, but it's certainly the best for the long-term. Bram has been a real rock for all of us. He has been steadfast throughout the years. He has an ability to be firm when he needs to be and yet warm and compassionate when he needs to be. He's really a unique man.
When he speaks, people really do listen. He's, you know, no bullshit, doesn't mince any words, likes to get to the truth.
Bram is a real person. What you see is what you get.
He's fair, very smart. He makes me laugh. His jokes, he's very funny.
He has a very good gut. He can kind of read what's going on, and that's always been one of his really one of his big attributes.
When I first came into the bank, I think one of the things that I thought was important as I saw us getting bigger was how important it was to capture the values, the cultural values of the bank.
My father's life, I think, reflects deep sense of giving back and helping others. And I think that there's a clear parallel in the values of the bank and my father's values.
Bram and I had... We were sitting next to each other last year at the Christmas party, and just by chance, he turned to me and he said, did you ever think this is what we would be doing? You know, are you not just not amazed that this is where we are? And I said, you know, Bram, I had absolutely no idea that this is where we would be and this is what we would be doing when I started this journey. And he said, yeah, we're really fortunate, aren't we? You know, we're really fortunate.
Shalom, tova uvracha, chen vachesed verachamim aleinu v'alko Yisrael. Amecha, amecha. Rachamim v'chayim v'shalom.
Sim shalom, tova u'bracha. Ein v'chesed v'rachamim aleinu v'yako Yisrael. Levarech et amcha Yisrael bechol et ubechol shah bishlomecha. Sim shalom tova uvracha chen bachesed v'rachamim ale Israel, Amecha, Amecha.
In just a moment, we're going to rise and join in Kaddish together. Before we do, just a couple of announcements. The first of which is to remind everyone that immediately following this memorial service, there'll be a reception outside, and everyone is invited to join together there and to honor Bram. I'm going to ask that once the service is concluded, that everyone please remain seated until the cantor and I have the opportunity to escort the family out of the theater, and then the rest of us will be free to go at that time. I want everyone to know we'll be reading Bram's name before we say Kaddish at every service for the next 30 days at Wilshire Boulevard Temple at both of our campuses, every Friday at 6 p.m. and every Saturday morning at 10 a.m., and everyone is welcome to join us there to honor Bram by saying Kaddish for him. And finally, a thank you to everyone for being here. There's not a single chapter in a single book I've ever read or written that has helped a family through a time like this. The only thing that helps is to be surrounded by people who remember and people who care. It changes nothing, but it means everything. So
truly thank you for being here today to be part of this, and thank you for being here for the rest of the days to come for Bram and for his family. Let's all rise now for Kaddish.
Yit gadal v'yit kadash shemei rabba. V'yalma divrach hirutei v'yamlich malchutei. V'chayechon v'yomechon v'chaye dechol beit Yisrael. V'agala v'zman kariv v'imru amen. Yehe shmei rabba mevorach le'olam u'almei almaya. Yit barach v'yishtabach v'yit pa'ar v'yit romam v'yit naseh. Vita dar, vita le, vita lal, shemei de kutsha brichu. Leela minko birchata vishirata, tush bechata venechemata, da amiran be alma vimru amen. Yehe shalama rabba min shemaya, vichayim aleinu veal kol Yisrael vimru amen. Ose shalom bimromav, huya se shalom. Aleinu, ve'al kol Yisrael, v'imeru. Amen. Please be seated.
There are stars up above, so far away we only see their light. Long, long after the star itself is gone. And so it is with people that we love. Their memories keep shining ever brightly, though their time with us is done. But the stars that light up the darkest night, these are the lights that guide us as we live our days. These are the ways we remember. We remember as we live our days. Yeah.